All right, so joining me to discuss the major political implications of this, political reporter at Bloomberg News, Sahil Kapoor, he is here. CNN legal and national security analyst and former FBI special agent Asha Rangappa is here. And CNN analyst and former spokesman for both the State Department and the Pentagon under President Obama, retired Rear Admiral John Kirby. It's great to see all of you. Thanks so much for coming in. So, Sahil, as Kevin's laying out, it seems that there is little expectation that President Trump is going to be bringing up the Russian cyber attack, but it's all up to him. So who knows what he'll come up with in that moment, maybe. That, if it does not come up, I mean, that seems that it's very likely to anger some in his own party on Capitol Hill who talk about it quite often and who are right now pushing new sanctions against Russia for this very thing.
It's a seminal political moment for him, Kate, for President Trump, in bringing up the question of, you know, what he's going to do and how he's going to confront an adversary that his own intelligence agencies and intelligence agencies in the United States believe inappropriately meddled in the United States election. If he doesn't do this now, there are concerns already among experts that Russia is going to try this again. But if this isn't dealt with appropriately in terms of sanctions and punishing them for doing this and beefing up our cyber infrastructure to make sure this doesn't happen in the future, this could come back to haunt him, and this could be a real blemish on his legacy if nothing is done about it. I'm sure you will hear demands from Democrats, in particular on Capitol Hill, that he bring this up. I don't know what Republicans are going to say about this publicly, but privately, many of them absolutely are concerned that the United States is not doing enough for this. And his own counterterrorism officials have said that Russia is going to attempt this again. And the only question is whether they succeed and what the United States does about it. Kate?
Well, and what is appropriate in coming up in these meetings? Let's talk about that. John, White House officials, they're not saying formally, like, what is exactly on the agenda or even the setting of how this meeting is going to play out. Listen here, if you will, to the president's Homeland Security Advisor, Thomas Bossert. He was asked about this over the weekend. Listen.
We don't know if this will be a long bilateral meeting or a shorter pull aside at this stage. Those details haven't been set. So in part, that format of that meeting will dictate what they discuss and how they discuss it. But I would say that if there's an opportunity, the president would recognize that we have an extremely low point relationship based on distrust right now. And while we should condemn their cybersecurity behavior, and we should condemn their behavior in the Ukraine and sanction them for it, and President Trump has said as much, he should also take opportunities to partner with them in ways that help us defeat ISIS and prevent the Syrians from using chemical weapons.
Okay, so I have two questions out of this one, John. Less than a week out, should they have these things settled? The time, the place, the agenda, should they?
Less than a week out for a pull-aside meeting like this, I'm not surprised that there's no formal agenda proffered by either side. I suspect the teams that are working at lower levels are trying to set all that. So I'm not surprised that there's not a specific agenda. What does bother me is when I hear General McMaster say, well, it's just going to be whatever the president wants to talk about. Now, I'm hoping he's being glib. I'm hoping what they're doing is sitting down and saying, Mr. President, these are the issues you must bring up with President Putin. Certainly Ukraine, certainly Syria. I'm not surprised that, you know, that Kevin is hearing that they're going to bring that up. But I do agree that this is a prime opportunity for him to raise the Russian meddling in our elections. And it's more than just that, Kate. It, you know, can't just be, hey, I'm bringing it up on the, you know, as a sort of circumstance or a consequence of the media. He has to actually have a point here and a warning to the Russians about not doing this going forward.
Does Bossert have some kind of an argument, though, John, that in the first face-to-face, that it's not the time to bring up the Russian hacking?
No, he's completely wrong. This is the time. This is the prime opportunity for the president of the United States to look Putin in the eye and say, look, our intelligence agencies know what you did. We're still investigating it. We're not going to tolerate this going forward. This is the chance. There's no better opportunity than that first meeting between the two men.
Hmm. Asha, one thing that everyone is waiting for is to, if we do get a glimpse of it, the body language between these two men. I mean, everyone remembers the stone cold greeting between Obama and Putin back in 2013. There are multiple examples of it between those two men over the years. I mean, what does this personal interaction between these two men, what does it mean for the entire relationship going forward?
Well, body language aside, I think that John and Sahil are right, that it matters much more what is said. And now there needs to be a strong message that the meddling in our election was unacceptable, because otherwise the Russians will be emboldened and believe that there's no consequences going forward. You know, it's interesting that the president has downplayed the Russian meddling, but is moving full steam ahead with this voter fraud allegation, which is baseless, and asking for all of this information from the states. And there's a national security issue here, because there are reports that Russia may have gone at the state level to interfere in potential voting. Whether they were successful or not is not clear, but if the fact that this information is dispersed among the states protects that information, if it's centralized with the voting commission, that's just open season for future attempts by Russia to get that information for their other attempts to meddle. So I think there needs to be a strong, direct message, not just body language, in this meeting.
Well, let's talk about a different kind of body language, like the body slamming kind of body language. Asha, I'll start with you. I don't know. It was some kind of a transition. Just go with me, folks. President Trump and his social and the video that he posted over the weekend, of course, hitting CNN and hitting the media in general over the weekend. But President Trump's Homeland Security advisor, again, Thomas Bossert, he was asked about kind of this beating up CNN video right when it came out. And when he was asked about it, he said that he would not perceive it as a threat. He would hope that no one would perceive it as a threat. And he said, I hope they don't. Do you see it as a threat, Asha?
I think that it is in direct contradiction to what Sarah Huckabee Sanders said last week, that he doesn't depict or promote violence in any way, whether or not it's a threat. We know from this attack on our congressman in the baseball mm-hmm. field that whatever is intended, there are people out there who will, you know, unhinged, irrational, who take these messages, internalize them, and may act on them. And of all people, the President of the United States should understand that, particularly in the wake of that tragedy, and be much more responsible and careful in what he puts out on a social media platform to 30 million viewers.
As a former spokesman to both the State Department and the Pentagon, John, when you saw that, you thought what?
I was stunned. I was aghast that this was coming from the President of the United States. Let me make two points. One, I've been at CNN now for a couple of months, and I've always worked on the other side of the journalist notebook, you know, being a flack and a spokesman. To come here and to see the rigor and the ethics and the professionalism that CNN applies to its reporting, not that I was surprised by that, but it certainly has been brought home clear to me every single day that I come to work, and I'm proud to be a part of this team, and it just stuns me that he is able to just make these wild accusations about the professionalism here. Number two, I moderated a panel at Georgetown a few months ago, right after the election, four young journalists, all in their early 20s. Some are freelancers, some work for a major daily newspaper here in the nation's capital. All of them said, in the wake of the president's election, all of them had received threats, whether it was electronically or mm-hmm. over the phone, all of them. I mean, this cannot be tolerated. I mean, whether he was joking or not, he's sending a message that this kind of violence is okay, and that the media are an okay target for violence. It's just unacceptable.
If you just look at the politics of the moment, Sahil, in your area of expertise, I mean, be it a threat or not, we do know one thing, that Republicans in Congress, they're losing patience with juvenile Twitter attacks that the president has been lobbying over, well, since he was elected and before, but especially since he's been president. This is health care. What the president did over the weekend, it has nothing to do with the key issue of health care. But do you see it impacting the debate over health care?
Kate, it's certainly evoking violence, if not explicitly calling for violence. The president's advisors and his allies can try to dismiss this as a joke, but presidents generally don't, you know, have a higher standard of behavior than this sort of thing. One thing that I think is really important that a new poll shows is that this rhetoric has an impact. It matters. 42% of Republicans now say that the United States has gone too far in expanding the right of a free press. That is an absolutely stunning statistic. That's according to a new NPR and Marist poll that's out. And it just goes to show that, you know, people do follow their political leaders, and this stuff has a real impact. Now, with regard to health care, it's a bit of a double-edged sword. On one hand, Republicans do prefer that to be the focus. They do prefer the president to be driving that message and to not get distracted on this sort of thing. But the health care debate, Kate, has been mostly playing out behind closed doors. The crafting of this bill has been very secretive, and it's not a popular bill. It's polling anywhere between 12% and 18% in the polls that have come out in recent weeks. So on some level, I think Senate Republicans may be happy that it's not at the top of the agenda while they're trying to cobble together the votes, twist arms behind closed doors, and get it done. It's a complicated thing, but nobody's condoning this sort of thing.
getting some of those arms twisted. Some of those senators who are on the cusp or are no's and who they're trying to make into yeses, though, they have been far from impressed or pleased with what they've been seeing from the president. So you wonder if he's just burning through more political capital as he tweets these things out for his agenda when he wants to get things done over in Congress. Thank you all very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.